We've been starting. One of the things, as I shared last week, was many of you all are brand new to this church. You've been here maybe a few years or so. You weren't here when I first got here. And talking about really what's this church all about? And why do we do the things that we do and everything that's there? A few years ago, actually, a gentleman by the name of Rick Warren wrote a book called The Purpose-Driven Life. And out of there came The Purpose-Driven Church. And so one of the things that everybody asked this question and hopefully answer and go to next week, and that is this. What on earth am I here for? What's all of this about? Because the first question that really each and every one of us asked in our existence is this: why am I alive? Not talking maybe from the point of when you were born, but right now. God, why am I here right now? Why haven't you already called me home? So what's my purpose here? Because God, you haven't called me home, you've left me here, so evidently God, you have got a purpose for me to fulfill. And I'm really having a hard time finding what that is. And then the second question is, when we ask ourselves, you know, why am I alive? The second question is, does my life matter? If I was to die today, would anybody really know? If I didn't show up next week for the rest of my life, would that matter? Or would I just be a blip on someone's screen that just went away? What is my significance in this? So then the third question says, why am I alive? Does my life matter? And if my life does matter, then I need to ask this question: is there a purpose for my life? What is it, God? Because may I say something to you all? The first question, why I am alive, may I say this to you? You are not the first person to ask this question. This is not a question that just happens to be of this generation. This is not a question that has been asked of just two generations. May I say to you this, that this question has been asked for thousands of years. You see, because many people in the Bible actually asked this question. Matter of fact, there's a guy in the Bible by the name of Jeremiah, a prophet, and he asked this question, why was I born? And here's what he says. Why was I born? Was it only to have trouble and sorrow, to end my life in disgrace? And this guy's having a bad hair day. And I mean, it's really fluffed out. God, why? Am I just going to go ahead and just have disgrace? You see, because he's really not in a good mood. Because he's asking the question, God, is this the reason that my life is here? Is to always, always have trouble and always have sorrow? And probably some of you all are asking that same question. God, it just seems like I go from one thing to another, to another, to another, to another, to another, to another, and God, it never seems to stop. And don't you understand, God, that I love you, I trust you. But why is it that my life is so stinking bad? I look around at everybody else and they seem to be doing okay. But I'm not. I heard a guy one time who said, I hope that life isn't a joke because I don't get it. I just don't understand. Or maybe you think that your life is like a play and you're already trying to figure out who's going to play that part. But you just can't figure out what's the plot line in this play that you've got me in, God. I just don't understand. You see, because if you continue to look at your life from your point of view, may I say this to you? You're never going to get it. The only way that you can understand why you're here is you've got to look at it from a different point of view. If you look at it from your point of view, you're not going to get it. So what we need to do is we need to just basically take you off and deprogram you right now. And I want to show you what the Bible says about how to look at your life to understand exactly why you're here, what you're here for, and what the purpose is that you're here for. Okay? Because you've got to change your point of view and how you look at your life. The first approach is to knowing the purpose of your life, or what you've got to understand is you've got to start looking at your way of life from God's point of view, not yours. So switch who's looking at it. So we've got to learn to look at our life the way that God looks at our life, okay? And by the end, we'll show you how to do that. You see, because a lot of times, if you don't look at your life the way that God looks at it, then you're going to look at your life in one of three ways. And the first is called the mystical approach. This is where you're going to find a lot of books out here right now that are New Age books. And they're trying to tell you all these things. You'll find these seminars and everything else. And it's kind of like, how many of you all have watched the movies? The Matrix or Star Wars? God, please pray for them right now. This is going to be a long day. How many of y'all have seen Star Wars? They're all trying to figure out these things. And they're trying to tell you that what you need to do the mystical approach is the way you've got to figure out what's your purpose in life is you've got to look inside yourself. And if you look inside yourself, you'll find something inside of you that will help you to understand this approach. It's like when in Star Wars, remember the big guy that's dressed in black? Yeah. And I believe there was a point in there where someone used these words, and I think it was him. He says, trust the force, Luke. Just trust the force. And you'll be able to see that. But you know what? Somebody needs to stand up and admit, this doesn't work. I've looked inside of myself. I've tried to find the force within me to help me understand the purpose of life. And you know what? He's to tell you, Luke, but Luke Skywalker, that doesn't work. It's not going to happen. All of these people that write these books that tell you to look inside yourself and you will find your purpose. Ladies and gentlemen, you can continue to look inside yourself all you want to, but you will never find out what your purpose is. All you're going to do is make them rich by buying their books. because it's not going to be found inside of there. Because let me tell you something. I've looked inside myself. And I can tell you something. I don't like what I saw. You may say, well, you're a pastor? Yes. And I am still human. And if I look inside myself to find my purpose, I'm going to tell you something. I do not like what I see or what I saw. And may I say to this, let's be honest. If you look inside yourself, you probably are not going to like what you see either. You may say, well, I like myself. Whoa, good for you. I like me too, sometimes. But I don't like me all the time. So if being bad sometimes is my purpose in life, I got that one. I always thought that my purpose in life that God gave me was to give everybody a hard time. And when I get to heaven, he's going to say, well done, my good and faithful servant. You've done it well. You gave a lot of people a hard time. But that's not the way it is. So follow me on this logic for just a minute. If you didn't create yourself, how do you know what makes you tick? You see, if you didn't create you, then you don't know why you were created. You didn't make yourself. Someone else created you. And someone else made you. And if that someone who made you and created you evidently knew what the purpose of creating you was. So it's not found in the mystical approach. The second one is in all of these self-help books. You can walk into all of these places and they've all got them. There's thousands and thousands of them. But there are not any self-help books that talks about purpose. Okay? Not one of these self-help books will tell you what your purpose is in life. They're built to help you and to go through these things. Instead, every one of these self-help books will tell you the same thing, that you've got to create a purpose. Not that you have a purpose, you got to create it. And when you create what your purpose is going to be, then you can reach inside of yourself and help yourself. But the problem is this, did you create yourself? And if you didn't create yourself, then how in the world can you create your purpose? So that doesn't work. They will always tell you to create your dreams, set your goals. And listen, there's nothing wrong with dreams and there's nothing wrong with goals. But you got to understand, are your dreams and your goals going to fit your purpose? Well, yeah, if I make the purpose, they will. But the problem is, how can you make the purpose because you didn't do the creation? So that doesn't work. Or there's a third way, and this is the great way. This is called the philosophical approach, okay? And in the philosophical approach, what you do is you go through all your life speculating on what your purpose is. You can go to UC, you can go to Miami, you can go to Xavier, you can go to any school that you want, and you can get your degree, and you can go to a Starbucks for the rest of your life, smoke a pipe. Well, you can't smoke a pipe in Starbucks anymore. But you can sit, if you wanted to, you could go to your home, sit in your cardigan sweater, smoke your pipe, have your degree, and speculate with your philosophy on, what am I going to do with the rest of my life? And you can be as philosophical about it all you want to and just dream about it and think about it, but it doesn't work. It's not there. But philosophy has its place. But all it's doing is guessing on what your approach is to life. It's not really telling you what it is. So, let me, for instance, if I was an inventor and I invented this box, and I was to show you this box and was to ask you, what is the purpose of this box? What would you say?
To hold Kleenexes.
To hold Kleenexes. But what if it wasn't my approach was not to hold Kleenexes? I just wanted to create a box that had a hole in it. That was my whole idea of creating this box, was just create a box to have a hole in it. But somebody decided, oh, okay, well, I've now found a thing to do with your invention. I've got a purpose for it. The purpose for your box is to hold Kleenexes. Well, you could say, yeah, that works, that's fine. Or somebody else could say, well, what I really want to do is I'm going to put a flower pot in it, and I want my flower to just come out the top. So that's the purpose of your invention. So you could say, well, I could use it as a flower trestle. Whatever. Or you could just say, I would really like to take it into my bathroom and sit there and speculate on what I could do with this thing. It's a thinking box. But unless you really know what I created this for, I was the one that invented it. And you could use it for many different things and many different purposes, but that is not what I created it for. I created it just because I wanted to make a box that looked pretty with a hole in the top of it. That was the only reason that I created it. So what was my purpose? My purpose was just to have it sit around and look good. That was my purpose. But yet you thought that it was made for something else. So you're going to use my box to do something that it was never meant to do. That's what we do when we do the philosophical and the other things that we do with our life. We think this is what it looks like and this is what it should do, and yet we forgot that the one that created it had a different purpose for it. And it doesn't necessarily mean the purpose that we think it's there for, because we're only looking at it from the point of view of our view, but we're not looking at the point of view from the Creator. So what I want you to do this morning is I want you to look at your life not from your point of view, but from the viewpoint of the one who created you. And let me share this to you. The one who created you made you for a purpose, and he wants you to know what that purpose is. Okay? And he is very specific about those things that he does. And he wants, and he will share about them. You see, because there's a lot of people that write a lot of good books, but they're really not helpful. There was a guy by the name of Joseph Heller who wrote a book. He's an author. And here's what he had to say. I have no answers to the meaning of life, and I no longer want to search for any. That's sad. Because if you feel that your life has no purpose and you're done searching for it, then what your life has now become is trivial. It's absolutely meaningless. And so we go that way. So, if you were to take God out of the questions, then you really don't have a lot to move on. So here we go. What are we here for? And why are we alive? This may be a shocker, but can I tell you, here's the answer. You want to know why you're alive? Because you were created to be loved by God. You were created to be loved by God. You want to know why you're alive? You're alive because God created you because he wanted to love you. That's not too deep. That's like kind of simple. Why am I alive? Very simply, you were created to be loved by God. Absolutely. So, can I say this to you? Absolutely amazing. It doesn't matter whether you are male or female. Whoa. Hold on a minute. You mean that God loves males and females? Oh, yeah. What if I only have 4 fingers? God still loves you. But I don't have all my fingers. Well, I guess you do only have 4 fingers, don't you? And a thumb. Whatever. What if I only have 4 digits, not 5? You mean God still loves me even though I'm not complete? Yes. You mean that God loves people who are not totally perfect? Yes. Why? Because ain't none of y'all perfect. And guess what? God loves y'all. Every one of you. Why am I alive? I am alive because God created me to love me. That is simple. As simple as it can be. So, what do I know? Well, I think the Bible tells me that God is love. Doesn't it? Yes? No? I think so. Yeah, okay. God is love. And if God is love, then God wants to give that love to me. He created me because he wants to love me. God doesn't hate you. I hear people all the time say, God, why do you do this to me? God loves you unconditionally, no matter what. 1 John chapter 4, on your sheet, it says, love comes from God. For what? For God is love. You need to circle that. For God is love. God showed how much he loved me. Why? Or loved us by sending his only son into the world so that we might have eternal life through him. So what does this show me? This shows me that God loves me. Why am I alive? Because God loves me. God loves me. And the Bible says that you were created to be loved by God. May I say something to y'all? God didn't need you. God didn't need me. Can I say something to you? God was not lonely. And one day he looked at all the angels and everybody else and he says, I am so lonely. He looked at all the stars and said, I am so lonely. I got to make somebody else because I'm so lonely. No, God didn't make us because he was lonely. God made us because he wanted to love us, a relationship that he could not have with any of the other creations. He loved us, and he brought us to that way. Do you know why your heart is beating right now? Do you know why you're breathing right now? Is because God loves you. He gave you a heart to beat and lungs to breathe. Something that is totally different. Because you know something? God wanted you alive, not dead. He wants you alive. And so you need to understand something. And that is this. If God created me to love me, can I share with you something? You can't make God stop loving you. There is nothing that you can do to make God stop loving you. Nothing. Now, let me say this to you. If you want to be a failure in life, try to do anything and everything that you can to say, God, I'm going to do whatever I want to do to make you stop loving me. And you know what? You're going to fail. At the end of your life, you're going to understand God still loved you. No matter who you were, no matter what you want to do. And you want to know why? Let me give you an epiphany this morning. You want to know why you can't make God stop loving you? It's out of character. God can never stop loving you, because if God ever stopped loving you, then he loses his character. Do you understand? It is totally out of the character of God to hate you. No matter what you do, he will never, ever hate you. Why did God send his son to die on the cross? The Bible says because he loved us. When did he love us? He loved me when I was a sinner. And guess what? He's still loving me, even with all of the bad things that I do. For instance, Ephesians says on your paper, long before God laid down the earth's foundation. That means even before he created the world, he had us in mind, and he settled on us as a focus of his love to be made whole and holy by his love. Do you ever feel like your life is fragmented and it's coming apart? And it just seems to, just one day you're sitting here and all of a sudden it seems like your whole life is just blown up. Well, you need to understand, how do I get wholeness in my life? The way I do that is I've got to experience the love of God. I've got to feel it and love it. Love it. Love God unconditionally, the way he loves you unconditionally. And the Bible says that he does, that even before you were born, God thought you up and said, I want to create this person so that I can love them. Now, everybody else will look at you and say, I can't love you. You know what? God says, so what? I do. There were times that my kids looked at me sometimes and said, you know what? I don't love you anymore. You're the worst parent in the world. How dare you? All the other kids got to do this, and I didn't get to do this, and I want to go live with him. Yeah, right? Okay, sure. No, you don't. You'll be back. I'm going to grandma's. There you go. Grandma will do everything. No, they find out real quick. Grandma and grandpa send them back home. So you need to understand is that God created a lot of things. But whenever you finally get to the point that we all do, there are times in our life that we get to a point of low self-esteem. We get to the point of insecurity, inferiority. We get to those points. Can I tell you something? Not with God. God loves you, continues to love you. Now, the second question that you were asking was, does my life really matter? There was a guy by the name of David. In Psalms chapter 89, he says, I remember how short my life is. Why did you create us? He asked, for nothing? He said, God, is that really what you created us for? Is just to put us here for nothing? Job asked this question. He says, why should I work so hard for nothing? Solomon says, laughing and having fun is crazy, but what good does it do? And they're asking these questions, what's going on? In the Second World War, the Nazis were trying to get rid of all of the Jews. So they herded them all into concentration camps, and they killed over 6 million of them. One of the things that they did when they took all of the Jews and brought them into the concentration camps was the very first thing that they began to do was they began to remove all meaning and purpose from their lives. Every bit of it. They knew that if people had meaning and felt that their life mattered, that they would hang on through all of these amazing tortures. But as soon as a person felt that their life had no more meaning and no more purpose, they would just die and just go away. In one case, in a Hungarian death camp, they were using the prisoners simply to do nothing but process sewage. That's all they did, just process the sewage, a low job. One day, the Allies came and blew up the sewage plant. They thought they were doing a good thing, but you know what they did? They just removed the purpose for why those Jews were in that place. And you know what happened? They died because they had no more meaning. So, what ended up happening was they just tried to keep doing things to make them want to do different things and all these things. And when the Allies would do something to them, sometimes if the people were still alive, they would move them over here and try to get them to do something else, and they didn't want to do that. And what it did is it just drove the people all crazy. And they began to just do anything they could to just die because they lost their purpose that they thought they had in this world. And unfortunately, can I tell you something? That's what's happening to a lot of Christians. They're just dying spiritually inside because they don't understand something. Every one of you here are living at one of three levels. There's a survival level, the success level, and there's the significance level. This has nothing to do with your Christianity. There are some of you in this congregation probably that are just living day to day and doing just anything you can to survive. You watch on TV and you'll see these episodes of things that they'll show of these people all around the world when all they're doing is trying to get water. They're trying to get food. They're trying just to survive. And some of you that think in America that you are living at the survival level, may I say this to you? And may I say this not in a derogatory manner, but no, you're not. You want to see survival? Go to Rwanda. You want to see survival? Go to some places in Afghanistan and Iraq. You want to see survival? Go to some places in Africa, in the Far East, where these kids, they have nothing. Their parents have nothing. Their whole family has nothing. May I say something to you? Most of you all have a house to live in. Most of you will be able to turn on the water and get fresh water. Ladies and gentlemen, there's people all around this world that can't do that. They're trying their best just to find the water to survive. And we got it at our taps and we complain so many times, all these things. But let me say this to you. There are some of you that maybe you're just existing. You get up in the morning, you go to work, or maybe you don't go to work. You turn on the TV and you watch it all day, and that's all you do. Or play Candy Crush. There's some people who say, well, I'd like to live at the success level. You know what? There's a lot of people that live at the success level and look how miserable they are. You say, well, no, you don't know what you're talking about. Hold on a minute. Let's talk about this for just a minute. People that are very successful. How many of y'all think that Jay-Z and Beyonce are successful? Huh? I mean, they're worth a lot of money, right? They're successful. In the eyes of this country, they are successful. Miley Cyrus. You may not like her. You may not like what she does and what she stands for, but would you say she's not successful? Okay? So if success gives you happiness, then why in the world was Miley Cyrus having a meltdown when Donald Trump got elected? If Jay-Z and Beyonce are so successful and success brought them happiness, then why in the world did all these people who are so successful, Barbara Streisand, Oprah, Whoopi Goldberg, and all these successful people say, then we're leaving the country? Okay? But you understand what I'm saying? These people that say that they are, if we think that success means you've got a lot of money and you've got a lot of popularity, that is not success. And then you come to the point of saying, well, what about significance? This is where I really, really matter to the world. If I die tomorrow, the world would fall apart. Because you see, the world revolves around me. I control this aspect of the world or that aspect of the world. Can I tell y'all something? You don't find your significance in the world. You find your significance in God. And when you learn that God believes you are significant because he sent his son to die. And here, we need to understand, first of all, that God cares about every detail of your life. There are so many times that we think that God doesn't care about anything in our life. Matthew chapter 10 says, not even a sparrow can fall to the ground without your heavenly Father knowing it. He says, the very hairs on your head are all numbered. For some of you, that's not hard. Okay? But that means if hair number 1,042 fell out of your head this morning and went down the drain, God knew that it was 1,042. So if God can count the number of hairs on your head, do you not think that God knows and cares about every detail in your life? Not just some of it, all of it, every bit of it. So the Bible says so, don't be afraid. You are far more valuable to him than a whole flock of sparrows. A whole flock of them. And that's how significant. The second thing, do you know that God planned your days before you were even born? Psalms 138 says this, for you, talking about God, scheduled every day of my life before I began to breathe. That means before you were born, while you were in the mother's womb, he scheduled every day of your life before you were born. Every day was recorded in your book. You want to know who's got the book of your life? It's God. Some of y'all saying, hold on a minute. You got to understand this. God is not confined with your time and my time. God saw the beginning and the end and everything in between, ladies and gentlemen. He knows every day of your life. He had it planned out before you even get up. This is why I say to you that you need to do this as a habit. Every day when you get up, you need to ask God, what does he have planned for your day? instead of you telling God what you've got planned for the day. Because what we do is we take our life and revolve it around our plans instead of, God, what did you have for me today? Who did you have me to meet? Who did you have me to see, or whatever else? Now, let me give you another little tidbit of advice, something that'll probably blow you away. How many of you, in being honest, how many of you all feel that in some way you let God down this week? Yep. And how many of you all feel that because you let God down, you disappointed him? Let me say this to you. Why do we disappoint someone? Huh? We don't live up to our promises, or we don't live up to our expectations, right? For instance, parents. We have children, right? And we expect our children to do certain things, right? And then all of a sudden our children do something that we don't expect them to do. And so we kind of feel that our child has disappointed us, right? Why? Because they did not live up to our expectations. Here's the reason that you cannot disappoint God. God already knows what you're going to do. The problem is that Satan is trying to tell us that God is disappointed with us because we did this. Do you know something? God already knew you were going to do it. How can you disappoint him when he already knew what you were going to do in the first place? If God knows every day of my life and he knows what I'm going to do, then how can I disappoint him? And some of y'all think I've lost my mind. Ask him. Because you got to understand, God's got our day scheduled, ladies and gentlemen. Not doing hurts us. Now, it may hurt God in some ways, but do you understand? Disappointing is not living up to the expectations. And sometimes what you've got to understand is that Satan puts guilt trips on us. Now, I'm not saying be happy because you didn't do it right. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying quit letting Satan put you in guilt trips that says, I failed. What you need to understand is that God is there to love you, wants to get you through this. The purpose in your life, ladies and gentlemen, when you fail or when you feel that you do these things, the purpose is this: to learn these things, to never do them again. And then go on. We need to understand something. Because the Psalms 138 says, for God scheduled every day of my life before I began to breathe. He scheduled it. God can see what's going on and what's happening, and we need to understand that because he already knows. You need to understand something, that we live on this earth, and in this day we get 24 hours because the earth is sitting there and it's revolving around the sun. 24 hours, it's revolving around and going, and so we got this thing going. 24 hours, and then taking 365 days to make that full circle around the sun. And it's doing that. But let me say this to you all. God is not limited by the earth circling or rotating around itself on its axis or rotating around the sun. God is not limited by time. And ladies and gentlemen, one of these days, neither will we. We won't be limited by the time that goes there. There are times when you go home at night and you're going to say, God, you won't believe what stupid thing I just did. I already know what you did. You're not telling me anything new. He already knows. He knows all about it. And these are the things that we fail to realize a lot of times. Okay? The third thing, and this is the biggest, and that is this. Do you know what God made you for? Last forever. When he made Adam, how long did he expect Adam to live? Forever. How long does God want us to live? Forever. But because of sin, we live down here temporarily, okay? So we need to understand that God wants us to live for all eternity. And so there is the fruit fly. How long does the fruit fly live? Huh? One day, 24 hours. God didn't make you to live 24 hours. God made you to live forever. And that's what God wants you to do. So we need to understand, then, what is the purpose of my life? And what you got to do is understand that there is a purpose. And in Proverbs chapter 16, it says the Lord has made everything for his own purposes. And that's what we need to understand. Let me finish real quick with just a story. And this is a story that actually happened back almost 10 years ago. And a lady wrote this book. Her name is Ashley Smith Robinson, okay? And she actually wrote this book. I think it's actually called, I got to find it now, Unlikely Angel, okay? And what it was in Atlanta, and I think it was right around 2007, there was this guy who was in the court. He was in the courtroom with the judge and everybody else. And all of a sudden, the guy got the gun from one of the guards and began shooting everybody in the courtroom. And he escaped. Okay? He shot up the courtroom. He killed a judge and a police officer. And there was a massive hunt going on for this guy in the city of Atlanta. And one night about 1 o'clock in the morning, he took a 26-year-old lady who was single by the name of Ashley Smith. The lady is now married, and her name is now Ashley Robinson. He took her hostage. He tied her up with electrical cords, held her at gunpoint. And while she was sitting there all tied up with him and at gunpoint, she asked him this question: can I read you the purpose-driven life? And he said yes. So, this story's been told all over the place. But here's the story from Ashley, okay? She says, I accepted Jesus as my Savior when I was about 7 years old. I come from a very big Christian, loving, athletic family. I was very much into sports, spent a whole life, a lot of time with my family and in the gym. I made good grades. I was a model adolescent. However, the summer before my senior year, I began doing drugs. I immediately liked the way the drugs made me feel. Drugs slowly became the driving force of my life. I got married at the age of 20. My daughter was born a few months later. I was at that time a dedicated wife, a dedicated mother, and dedicated partier on the weekends. However, 2.5 years after marriage, my husband and I went to a weekend party, and I watched him get stabbed to death and die in my arms. Obviously, by telling you that, God was not a priority in my life at the time. I believe that God was calling me at that time to work in my life. However, I was too busy partying, and I told God that he'd have to wait and use me later on. After watching my husband die, my partying went from weekend partying to 24-hour-a-days, 7 days a week, to deal with the pain and everything else that was going on in my life. The truth is, I was a drug addict. But I wouldn't have told you that. I would have just told you I was having fun and maybe one day I'd stop. That is what I convinced myself of. But when my daughter was 3.5 years old, I could no longer take care of her because I couldn't even take care of myself. My addiction had gotten that bad, and at the request of my aunt, I allowed my daughter to stay with my aunt until I could get my life together. That process of getting my life together began in 2003, and I was in and out of many rehabs, leaving because I really wasn't ready to do it or whatever. But I finally, in 2004, I completed a program, a 3.5 month program. I left the program and I moved to Atlanta. I was originally from Augusta and I moved to Atlanta, got a job, two jobs actually. I enrolled in medical assisting school and I began doing okay in my life. However, 2.5 months after completing the rehab program, I thought I all had it together and I actually began to do drugs again. So I spent those 10 months trying to hide my then active drug addiction from my family. Actually, in February of 2005, I went to Augusta for a weekend visit with my daughter, Paige. I went to church for the first time in many, many years. It was there that they were beginning this thing called 40 Days of Purpose. They were handing out the books. I picked up one of the books and I knew at that point in time God was calling. He was knocking at my door, but I was really, really scared to answer the call because my life was in such a mess. I didn't think God wanted anything to do with me. How could God be knocking at my door is what I was saying. But he was, and I really had absolutely nothing left. So I answered the door, and God really, really began to work in my life at that point in time. I took the book home. I began to read it. Over the next 33 days of my life, I read a chapter a day. I read the verses in the Bible. I wish I could tell you that my drug use had completely stopped. I really wanted it to. However, at that point in my life, it did not. I stopped using during those 33 days, but there was a difference this time. When I used, I got mad at myself and I could feel God's arms around me saying, "It's okay, get up and keep going. Maybe we'll do better next time. Just keep going, Ashley, I'm here." So I kept going. On March the 11th, 2005, like most of you know, Brian Nichols, and this is when this happened in 2005, took me hostage. I was in my own home. My story of being taken hostage is a story, she says, of two redemptions. Most people, you know, he said, I read to him from The Purpose-Driven Life, and he let me go and turned himself into the police. What a lot of people do not know was that I was struggling with drugs. Like I just told you, I couldn't break free of that on my own. I was trying to calm Brian Nichols down that night and do everything that he could possibly, and do everything that he possibly said so I could make it out of there alive. I had drugs in my apartment that night, and he asked me for drugs. I gave him those drugs. That is really when God changed me and set me free, because I had to make the decision of whether I was going to do those drugs with him or whether I was not going to do the drugs with him. It was kind of a no-brainer for me, because it was like I can do drugs and die and go home and meet my Savior high, or I could choose not to do them and see what he's going to do with the rest of my life. So that's what I chose, and I haven't touched drugs since. It's been a wonderful blessing in my life. That really is the second part of the redemption. But really, my life has really, really changed since that morning, because I completely let go of the good, the bad, and the ugly, everything. I let God have all of it and wanted to see what he could do with it, because I'd made a mess of my life. How could I do that? I immediately began to dig into God's word to find out more about him and who he was. Who is this God who has literally reached down in the pits of hell, the pits of my drug addiction, and pulled me out of it and say, "I love you"? So I began to dig into the Bible and get the information. I, of course, finished the book. I began to pray for Christian friends, Christian mentors, people in my life. Up until that point, I didn't have a very good influence. I didn't have very good influences in my life. They were lost just as I was. That's kind of what I do now. Maybe that they will see that they can be saved by the grace of God. But as a result of praying for those types of people to come into my life, I was flooded with those types of people. They helped me on my road to being close to God. I began to learn how to be a Christian mom, a Christian woman. That was very important to me, because I really got involved in a church in Augusta, Georgia. The youth girls there were really my passion. I spent a whole lot of time with them and just poured my life into them and got some great results out of it. For them and for me, it was a blessing for both of us. Really, the biggest thing that is, I began to realize what my purpose was from God. I'm not there yet. I haven't arrived until God calls me home. That's the truth of it all. But I began to realize that God wanted to take some of the mistakes that I had made in my life and turn them around and use them for his purpose. My drug addiction is kind of an embarrassing thing to talk about sometimes. However, it's me. It's who I am. It's who I was. God used it for his purpose now. I want people to know that if there's anybody that's like me, God loves you. You're no different than me, and he is waiting. He's just waiting on you to completely surrender and say, I love you. Let me take this and turn it around. I choose to be honest about those things today. It doesn't make me any less. It makes me saved by God's grace, and that's the best thing to be in the whole world. My daughter Paige, she's been with me since 2005, ever since this happened, and our relationship is truly healed. It's been wonderful, and it's grown. She says that Pastor Rick told you, he says, my name is Robinson. I got married this summer to a man who's been in the same place I was too, and God reached down and pulled him out of it too. Loved him enough to bring him out of it too. So he's experienced the same thing. We're just on this journey of life together. The only difference now than was before is we let God lead this journey. I can tell you that we haven't been happier in our lives letting God to be, or we have, I can tell you that we haven't been happier in our lives letting God be the leader. That has been the best experience ever. The faith that I look forward to most is to one day hear my Savior say, well done, good and faithful servant. Going and speaking around the U.S. and Canada and all the places that I've been has been a blessing to me, but it's been a calling of God that I say, I disobeyed for a long, long time, but now I owe the rest of my life to you, and it's an honor to do that. I used to be addicted to drugs, but now I'm addicted to God's love, and that's a good thing to be addicted to. That, ladies and gentlemen, is understanding that God has a purpose. No matter what's happened in your life, God can take those things and use them for his purpose. So the thing is, what on earth am I here for? Ladies and gentlemen, you're here to let God love you and show his love to others around about. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you for this day that you've given us. Father, for those that have come. Father, we ask and pray that your message, your sermon, your words, God, would have reached and touched the hearts of those that are here this morning. For those that are searching, God, for a purpose in their life. For those here this morning, God, that have no idea what they're doing. They're looking for that significance. Father, they're looking for survival. Help us to understand, Father, that in your eyes, we are significant. Because, Father, you would have come to die on the cross through your son, even if one of us, just one of us, had accepted you. But Father, there's many, multitudes that have. And God, help us to understand through this time, Father, that everything that happens in our life is for a purpose. It happens for a reason. And God, may we take those purposes to point them to you, that you get glory out of it. Father, for the things that we begin to be ashamed of, Father, that's who we are, and you love us regardless. And Father, we thank you and we praise you this morning, for we ask it in thy son Jesus' name, and amen.
Hello, this is Pastor Chuck Cotton from Calvary Baptist Church. First of all, I'd like to say thank you very much for taking the time out to either listen to our sermon or to watch it on video. We are grateful that you've actually taken the time and hope and pray that it has been a blessing to you, as it was to us as we delivered it to our congregation. We ask if you have any questions whatsoever that you email us at PastorChuck@CalvaryBaptistMiddletown.org, or you could come and give us a phone call, if you would please, at area code 513-423-7251. I'd like to take this opportunity to also invite you to come to our church and visit us, if you would please. We actually have small groups on Sunday morning starting at 9:30, with our morning worship following at 10:45. Prior to our morning small groups, we also provide donuts with coffee, milk, orange juice, a time for fellowship, get to know each other, have a good time before we actually break out into our small groups for Sunday. Our worship services are uplifting, they're fast moving, and everything in our service is just a fast pace. But we do take time every once in a while to slow down as we feel the Holy Spirit moving. And we never want to hinder it in any way. We also have on Sunday evening, during the school year, we have Awana, and Awana starts with Apugles, actually from age 2 all the way up through high school. And during that period of time, we also have a worship service. Both of these start at 6 o'clock and end at 7:30. Our Wednesday night, we have a Bible study, which starts at 7. We generally finish about 8:15. We would love for you to come and visit with us. Don't have to dress up, just come as you are, because to us, it doesn't matter. You're a child of God, a creation of His, and so to us, you're important to everything that we do. Our motto here is building the kingdom one life at a time, and we hope that we have a chance to visit with you, get to know you as you get to know us. So thank you, and may God bless you. Great.